Recently, I've been getting a lot of requests to go over the different types of warps. That's exactly what I'm going to do in this video. Please note that painting warps will get their own video because they're a different kind of beast to tackle. I also recommend you get the newest version of Fast64 as it has some quality of life features that we'll be using in this video. To get started, I've got an example level here. We're going to get started with fading warps, so I'm going to Shift A and add a new empty plane axes. I'll set the type to object and the behavior to fading warp. Parameter 2 decides the ID, which I'll set to hex 0C. We then need our second destination warp, so I'll just Shift D to duplicate and move it over. I'll change the ID here to be 0D, and just so they're easier to see in game, I'll add a couple of planes to mark their location. I'll also move all four of these objects into the area node. Then, inside of the area node's properties, I'll add two new warp nodes and set the IDs to 0C and 0D. Then I'll change the level on both to JRB, and then set the destination nodes accordingly. If we go ahead and export and build our decomp, when we load into JRB, we'll see the two squares, and they'll teleport us back and forth. However, what if we only want a one-way warp? Since warps teleport you to the ground, we can go ahead and get rid of this plane and move this warp high in the air. This essentially makes it a one-way warp, since Mario can teleport to, but not from, the warp. Moving on, we can change the door warps. I'll duplicate and move this over, and change the behavior to door warp. Then change the ID to 0E, create a second one, and change its ID to 0F. Door warps are a little different, where you do want a model. For now, I'll just pick the 0-star door, but we'll come back to models in just a second. I'll add the corresponding warp nodes, and check out the level. There's one issue, there's no door to be seen. Of course, if I run into it, it works, but that doesn't really feel right. The issue comes from the fact that we're using JRB as our level, and there's no door loaded in here. We have two options here. We can either use a level that already loads in the door model, like Castle Inside, or we can load in the model ourselves. The two places models are loaded in are the scriptfunc global calls and this block of model loads. But before we get to loading a model, we'll first check out the model IDs.h file. Here's the model that we're trying to use, and we can see that it has ID hex 22. Luckily for us, nothing else uses this ID. But if we wanted to load in, say, this castle wooden door, and also the courtyard wooden door into the same level, we would run into an issue. Because both of these use 27, the level wouldn't be able to load both of them at the same time. There's a couple solutions here, and one of them is to just change it to a different ID. Or you could add your own define down here and set the ID to whatever you want. For our case, I'll just be using this custom model ID, but right now this hasn't done anything yet. We still have to load the model into our level, and so I'll go back to the script.c, and there are two ways we can load it in. The first is to add it to a scriptfunc global call. Inside, we can see it's just a bunch of model loads. Do note that global 1 is used for every level, whereas global 5 is shared between DireDireDocs, JRB, and the secret aquarium. So any models I add here will affect all three of these levels. Alternatively, we could just add a model load down here, which is exactly what I'm going to do. Since I added a custom model ID, there's one last thing to do. I'll change the model ID to custom and use that custom ID that we created. Now if we load in JRB, we'll see the doors are exactly the way we wanted them. Now for instant warps. Instant warps are a bit different as they don't really use any sort of object. Instead, they're driven by collision and floor types. I've divided up the floor a little bit so I can set this section to an instant warp, and I can assign it to a new instant warp material I just created. Right now the collision type is default, but if I click show all options, we can see a bunch of instant warp options. The naming is a little bit stupid, but we can treat these as 0, 1, 2, and 3. I'll go ahead and select the first one. That's actually all we need for the floor to work, but we still need to add a new warp node to the area. I'll go ahead and add a new warp node and set the type to instant and the ID to 0. Now's the time to explain a little bit about instant warps. So let's say Mario runs into the floor at this spot. We'll call this his ideal spot. When he collides with this, we want to send him back to this spot, which is the ideal ending spot. Similarly, if he lands over here, we'll send him back to here. And the way this works is by taking his current position and offsetting a specific amount. This is used for infinite hallways or for seamless area transitions. Previously, you had to place an object here and an object where you wanted Mario to be, and manually calculate this offset, and then translate it from Blender units. Fortunately, the newest Fast64 update takes care of this for us. So I'll show you my ideal flow for this. We'll start by going to Edit Mode and switching to Edge Select and selecting the ideal edge that Mario will run into. So for example, if this was a hallway, he'd be coming down this way and would touch this edge. Then we can Shift S and cursor to selected. This puts the cursor in the middle of the edge. I'll then leave Edit Mode and add a new empty object. This won't actually show up in the level and it's just for Blender's use. Then I can Shift D and move it back to where I want Mario to be when he teleports. I'll name these Warp Start and Warp In respectively. If we then go back to our area node, we can then select the Offset Objects option and select the Start and End. Blender will automatically calculate this for us and take care of the offset. At this point, if we export the level, this works perfectly.